Actually, I don't want to give too much of an introduction because he'll speak for himself. In other words, let's say whatever he says, just either accept it or think about it. You don't have to take it as dogma or anything like that. There is no dogma. And hopefully you'll get a great message that will help you on your spiritual journey or your life journey, whatever you want to call it. So, I can say a million things, but I think I'd like to have David come up now. So, welcome, David. We're going to have a nice chat today and talk about love and God and forgiveness and all kinds of good stuff. And I'm always honored to come together wherever I go. And I should say, too, that I just go everywhere on invitations, because when you get into a state of joy, it's really a state of contentment. There's no way to fix, there's no way to change, you're not going to try to convert anybody, proselytize any ideas, you know, it's very much the state of all the perfect, and it's just a state of acceptance. And recently, this past year, I was in Dallas, Texas, and somebody said, well, if it's all so perfect, then why go anywhere? And I said, yeah, that's exactly right, but why go anywhere? But the people invite me. And I think, oh, that's fun, I'll go there. And so, this past year, was to other countries, and, you know, lots of travel that has been over the last 12 or 13 years, so I'm happy to be back out in Los Angeles. I started out my first trip when I got a call from the Spirit, I started traveling, and Los Angeles was one of the stops on the first trip when I came out through California back in 1991. Started just kind of traveling and living on faith and, you know, the stuff that we've heard from different traditions, like the Bible, you know, seeking first the kingdom of heaven. All things else will be added unto you, and, you know, look at the lilies of the field, and all of the beautiful things about this is shining the light and trusting that everything will be taken care of, and that you don't have to plan for how you're going to take care of yourself. You just have to be willing. Come on in! You're right on time! We're just starting. That's beautiful. That's sweet. And, My journey has been one of learning to trust in the higher power, the Holy Spirit, or whatever you like to call it, that voice within, this small, still voice within, and learning to be completely dependent on that intuitive voice and transcend the ego or the voice of fear and doubt, conflict and war, whatever you like to call it. So that's been my journey. And I have to say that with this transformation of consciousness just comes all this joy, this bubbling up of joy where you feel like you just carry along every day and every moment, because you're just floating along and you really don't have any expectations, so you can't really get disappointed because it's always perfect, and wherever you find yourself or whoever shows up is part of that perfection. So you include everything in it. You're not trying to say, oh, that's not me, or you're not trying to reject or exclude anyone. You're just like including everything and everyone in. And it's also a path of no control. You find that when your trust is really strong in this voice, that you find you have no sense of trying to control the world. It's really like you're watching a movie and you're just enjoying it. Welcome. And you're enjoying everything that happens, just kind of like just watching and flowing and flowing. And, I was recently out here in California, Scott Murray, I was up in San Damiano, a Franciscan retreat center, and I was way up there, and they kept showing up at my lunch table. Like 10 or 12 lunch tables, and they did all the lunch table, and then finally, the very end of the last day, Minister Tony Ponchalla, who had organized things, and they said to him, we're going to kidnap David. incredible joy and regular to the parking space. And she goes, before we get to the place, she'd say, now parking space, and we got like 6 consecutive parking spaces right there. But it's like you're not trying to do anything or control anything, but you're just living in the joy. And then everything you do, everyone you meet, everywhere you go, just reflects that joy. And we just had lunch before we got here today. And so we were at a nice restaurant down the street, and the whole place was lit up. And people taking our pictures, and you know, taking away from the news. The whole idea of spirituality, where people talk about sacred sites, or sacred places, sacred gurus. You know, we start to live in the joy of that it's all love, and that who you are is love. And that when you're in touch with who you are, then everything around you just reflects that love. And that's really what this awakening is about. Welcome, come on in. So, I just show up at these gatherings. I never had anything planned to talk about or planned to say. I just am in a state of happiness and joy. And generally, in these kind of situations, people just start asking questions about, you know, about the state of mind, about questions about faith and forgiveness, how do you get in touch with grievances, and how the mind works, questions about the universe, the cosmos, and different things, metaphysical questions. I always say there's no good questions or bad questions. It's all perfectly orchestrated, so don't hold back on anything. Don't feel like there's anything taboo or whatever. Just let fly with whatever comes to your heart. Because I also feel like spirituality is meant to be practical. It's not, we don't need any more theologies. We've got enough theologies on the planet right now. Everyone's going for an experience. And that's really what religion is. It's not a theology. What I'm going to talk about today is not about a particular book. I'm not an advocate of any particular book or path. When I travel to other countries and this and that, I just let the symbols come in a way that they're most helpful. So if I'm invited to a country where they don't talk about Jesus, that's fine with me. I've done gatherings this past year, and one man identifying himself as Arthur the Atheist. And so I'm like, great, happy to meet you, Arthur. And you know, he was saying, you know, well, I'm an atheist, but I think that if there is a God, that his name must be Arthur. I said, okay. And he said, and I believe that we're all connected, and we're all part of one line. And, hey, Arthur the Atheist! We are. So I would say from the day of enlightenment that you find yourself unable to make distinctions anymore. It's not like you stop judging, you just find that you're incapable of judging. So I don't know what is believers or non-believers. What's the difference between a believer and non-believer, or someone who believes in God or not? There was a book that Jesus dictated called The Psychodermic Pamphlet, where he said, this is from Jesus Christ, who belief in God is unnecessary, for God can be but known. In other words, the beliefs of the studies does. And it doesn't matter whether you even have a formal belief or not. In the end, when you learn to forgive and release all the error from your mind, regardless of what you believe in, you have an experience of God. And that's what he meant by, I and the Father are one. That you know that who you are is a beautiful creation of God. Perfect, eternal, changeless. So, these gatherings are a lot of fun for me because I feel like it's always brand new. Even though I've been doing them for like 13 years, every question seems like it's the first question, and I don't ever really have a sense of the past. So it's always brand new. And it's like a childlike sense of wonder. So it doesn't matter what culture I go to or what country I'm in or whatever, you know, the smile is a universal language, and there's so much that's conveyed just in our sharing the joy in the presence of God. It really doesn't have anything to do with, you know, theologies and stuff like that. So, here I am, and
welcome.
Thank you. And we have plenty of us offered to have a microphone, so letting other people be the rolling microphone.
Person.
No, I can be the microphone. I have everything. Play the microphone.
There we go.
Was there a point in... Was there a point when you arrived where you made a total commitment to God? Like a time when you can distinguish that you made a big shift and quit trying to identify with your conceptual self and totally made a total commitment to follow guidance and surrender to God.
Yeah, I think the one of the big shifts seemed to be around 1991 when, I mean, I've been into the course and was having all kinds of mystical experiences and everything, but I pretty much, the voice was just saying that in order to remain constantly happy, I would have to be completely disidentified from everything in this world and completely identified with God. And that's the way I would be defenseless and be joyful and happy no matter what the situation. So that would not identify with the person of David or any particular group. In the end, not even to identify with the Course of Miracles. And I've had some beautiful lessons around that over the years where I was at a bookstore and a woman said, "Can I see your Course of Miracles book?" And it was all worn out. You couldn't even bring the gold letters were worn out of it. And she just took it and it was reminded me of Peter Sullivan in the Pink Panther movie where, you know, can I have your coats and entire car and everything? And I just drive it off. Out the door, and everything. And she was gone for about a minute, and then she came back, and she put it back in my hand, and she said, "Just testing." But it was a good lesson in being detached from everything. Because if you really aren't affiliated with anything in this world, then you have nothing to defend. I mean, you show up, you're kind of clueless about the world, welcome. And you're tuned in with God, and this beautiful state of mind being, you really identify with your source and not identify with the things of this world. Because all defensiveness means that you're tied into some kind of illusion concept that you think has to be defended or protected. And in the end, what you realize is your true self, or your spirit, or your Christ self, whatever you want to call it, doesn't need any defense. It just is. Truth is just it, and it's so beautiful when you begin to open up and identify with that, because then you lose all the sense of defensiveness. So it was around 1991 when I first started traveling, and right away, I remember an early gathering in Florida. I was in a small living room, and everyone was packed in there, and the little dog Sparkles watching us all, and there was a gathering I did down there where there was an elderly woman that was kind of sitting in front of me. And as I just began to talk, like 15 seconds into the talk, her fist went up in the air, kind of like the Mexican Olympics, you know. And she said something to the effect of, you know, "You, here we go again, you left brain, intellectual male, think you know everything, think you know more." But I was so disidentified from everything, I just kind of watched, and then at the end of it, there was nothing to address or whatever, I just continued on with the talk. And because, you know, it's kind of like you just become so joyful in the moment that you're not identified. I was not identified as left brain or male or intellectual or anything that makes sense. Okay, and I'm off and on. And sure enough, she kept showing up and gathering and taking notes. And, you know, if you don't give any meaning to anything, as if it's like, if you don't take anything personally, what you find is that everyone's adorable. I mean, I say everyone's sweet, because when you don't have any judgment, that's where everyone becomes so loving and sweet, because you've got nothing to defend and you're not trying to promote anything or whatever. So in answer to your question, Mervyn, it was probably about 1991 when I first started traveling. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Okay.
So, do you have any suggestions? how one would arrive at that place. Because I have a problem with forgiveness and judgment and criticism and letting things go. And I struggle with them a lot. And I can see that you really achieve that. I mean, it's like all over you, you know, just beams from you. And so, do you have any suggestions, any how one goes about doing that? Or is it just, you know, through constant meditation and reading, studying?
Yes. I have a yearbook of global awareness online called Awakening Christ that answers questions from all over the world. And I get the how question a lot. Like, how do you do this? How? What's the magic formula? You know, tell me. And I would say that the how is the spirit within you, whether you call it the Holy Spirit or the higher power or whatever, that when God gave you a means to wake up to who you really are, God gave you everything. In other words, the spirit within you, that intuitive voice, is the how. So when you learn to tune in and pay attention to that intuitive voice, there is your answer. In other words, it happens through you automatically when you tune into that. So basically what you're looking at is a resistance to that listening. It's the belief that you can run the show, so to speak. That's what the ego is, autonomy. I don't need anyone, I can run on my own. Or the flip side of the error is like the enmeshment dependency error, where people get dependent on a partner or a guru or a minister or an avatar or something. Like, all I need to do is test the hem of their garment or go to this place in India and find the right ashram or the right vortex or the right whatever. And what the Lord is teaching, what I teach, is that there's no person, place, or thing and thing more special than any other person, place, or thing. That you're it. In fact, the Course teaches that Jesus said that the kingdom of heaven is within you. And in the Course of Miracles, he says the word within is actually unnecessary. The kingdom of heaven is you. Of course, they say in the Matrix language, you are the one. And in order to accept that, it seems to be that the path is a path of allowing everything in your mind that is a block or a doubt to come to the surface. So I always say you have to take the lid off of that repressed, all those repressed unconscious beliefs. So when people ask me about how do you do this, or what is the fastest way to uncover the ego or expose it, or get in touch with it and release it, I think I always say that the two things that I've discovered were silence and relationships. Silence, if any of you have ever tried to go out for like a quiet retreat to still your mind, you know, like in a hermitage or a convent or a monastery or whatever, you know it can seem pretty difficult when the chatter doesn't want to stop. And when you go out, sometimes the chatter even gets louder. Like I'm saying, no, we're not going to do this. We're not going to stay in mind. And I would say relationships are very helpful because everyone's piece of meat is a reflection of what you still believe in your mind. So it's the mirror effect of whoever's in your life and you have any kind of irritations, annoyances, frustrations, whatever, that's a real good touchstone or an inroad into getting in touch with what you believe. And that's why this is a path that includes and uses relationships instead of like the old traditional path of, you know, go out to the Himalayas and get away from all the people and all those, you know, seeming issues and conflicts. You might go looking wherever you go, so you might as well take advantage of every single opportunity and use it to the hilt instead of thinking, oh, if I only stay on the Pacific Ocean, then I'd have peace of mind. It's tempting to think that there's certain scenarios or places that are more peaceful, but it's actually, as the Course says, you know, the holiest spot on earth is where an ancient hatred has become a present love. It takes it away from form and time and space, and brings it back to that still point in your mind, which is always there. You can always go to it. And I would say that you don't get to go on a witch hunt in your mind. Every day is a full place. You don't get to go reading just your desire to say, I want to have peace and joy and love and happiness. That's like calling on God, big time. And then I think of it kind of like back in the time of the glaciers, you know, the glaciers moved across the continents. They would just move anything in their way out of the way. It didn't matter how long the tree was or how big the tree was, it would flick out that tree like a toothpick because it's such a giant mass of light, of light. And you might think that when you call on God and you call for healing, God is like this giant glacier of light in your mind, and that will force up into awareness of anything that's unlike yourself. So a lot of times when you really call on healing, your life can seem to get worse experientially before it seems to get better. Louis Hale, great analogies, he's saying, cleaning the mind and clearing the mind of all the debris is like cleaning a turkey pan after Thanksgiving. Because there's the water in it and the soap in it and the stuff it up, then you gotta scrape the sides, and she said, the water gets a lot dirtier before you finally are able to rinse and clean the pan as far as clean. So that should be encouraging to know when you're on this journey, that when you call on God and it seems to get tense, maybe more tense than before, don't think that you're doing something wrong. Just know that the ego is getting flushed up out of its hiding space and that you're on a good road again.